few years. We've been very fortunate, and Rem has been extremely generous to come back to the school pretty much every year. And he's talked about his experiences and projects ranging from the Pearl River Delta, the publication of the book SML Excel, his work on shopping, more recently his explorations of Africa, and he's also touched on the mirror reverse of his OMA practice, AMO, the consultancy side of the practice. But for the last few years, there's been a kind of concentration of projects and preoccupations in the States, a place where he started, really, his work with the research that he did on Delirious New York. And then, of course, with the work on the Universal Studios, and the practice has gone on to be involved with the Seattle Public Library, Prada stores, Guggenheim, Whitney, hotel collaborations with Herzog & de Meuron and other projects. In many of his work, and in a sense in terms of the direction of the practice, one could say that Rem operates in a fashion that is somehow trying to operate opportunistically, to find the best conditions and possibilities from the circumstances that are given. Sometimes I think this method of work also gets him into a little bit of trouble with certain critics, but last time I think he was here, already you, I think we sensed that he was more explicitly also touching on the question of the political, which I feel is in a sense engaging his thoughts more and more. And in the context of the tragic events of September 11th in New York, where one of the main icons of modernism, the airplane, was responsible for the annihilation of the other, the skyscraper, I think we've all have had to accept that it's also the time for reflection, for rethinking one's practices. And in the light of these events, I have asked Rem to speak more specifically about America and American projects in more general terms. Rem Koolhaas is a graduate of the AA and the winner of the Pritzker Prize for Architecture. Please welcome Rem.
Thank you very much. Can it be, okay. Can you make the auditorium dark? I think it is inevitable to talk about the World Trade Center, although it is also inevitable that you cannot say the last word and that it is an event that we cannot really understand at this moment and whose implications are still completely in the future. But nevertheless, I have decided to kind of raise a number of issues that are associated with it, basically through the lens of America and indirectly through the lens of a couple of American architects, Robert Venturi and Denise Scott Brown, who have been perhaps the guiding architects, and maybe you're surprised to hear me say this, but the guiding architects in America over the last two and a half decades. I think that when I first came to New York, it seemed very evident what the World Trade Center was. It was a kind of insertion of pure idealism in the skyline of Manhattan, and that was admittedly a very naive interpretation. But it seemed to me to have an almost irresistible pull and attraction to the kind of similar idealism or an equal idealism as it has once existed in Europe. I came to America in 1972, and I think in retrospect, you have to admit or see that that was also the beginning of a kind of financial regime that was perhaps equally political with him, particularly to the extent that through a series of measures we came over the past 30 years gradually to abandon the state and to embrace the market as a kind of overriding mechanism. And I think that all our work, including my own, can only be kind of seen and interpreted in terms of that shift. I think in every picture, absolutely stunning, but what is equally stunning is that if you are in New York now, you cannot even remember the picture and not even remember the site where they are. Anyway, by sheer coincidence, I was asked 2 weeks ago to speak in New York on a forum or an evening that was supposed to commemorate the publication of Learning from Las Vegas. It was called Viva Las Vegas, and it was kind of supposed to focus on the Venturis. In a way, it was an incredibly inappropriate match because it was only three weeks after the event, and you could sense that New York was still completely raw, that the mood was undergoing extreme mood swings almost by the hour, and that the brief of the symposium was actually impossible because either by talking about New York you had to insult the Venturis, or by talking about the Venturis you had to insult New York. But I was able to find a connection, but perhaps it was a very unpleasant connection. The Concorde, the World Trade Center, and Learning from Las Vegas all appeared in 1972. In other words, they all were dating from the same year, and I think it was perhaps a very significant year. All products of a lavish confidence, and of cultures striving in a single direction forward. I think that in both the case of the Concorde, the World Trade Center, but even in the case of Learning from Las Vegas, there could be no doubt that they were forward-looking products, that they were taking a position in kind of modern current, that and that they were to a large extent products of a culture that was at that point kind of remarkably coherent, cohesive, and striving in a single direction. I also said that the Venturis had kind of actually achieved a very interesting status at this moment, because the current status is enviable. The dialectics of this couple, and then I'm talking about Venturi and Scott Brown as two separate entities, but as significantly a couple. And so this was the poster, just so you can imagine the almost painful inappropriateness for which they were not to be blamed, and nobody was to be blamed, but which hung in the air extremely heavily. The dialectics of this couple were the earnestness and stubbornness of the one enables the continuing frivolity of the other, is a kind of reciprocal shielding that has enabled them to engineer a rare mixture of huge influence and relative unpopularity, which, needless to say, today almost corresponds to virtue. What I think is amazing about the Venturis is that they are so deeply unpopular that almost no one is influenced by them anymore. And in that sense, they have achieved an almost utopian luxury of being important without influence. And I think it is particularly in the kind of economic political shift that I described a rare achievement, because it means that they are perhaps the only ones among architects who have known to be and to remain systematically indigestible. And I know what I'm talking about. Nevertheless, of course, learning from Las Vegas launched a famous dialectic between these two images, in which it kind of described the choice that architects had at that point. The thing doesn't want to go in which they described the choice that was open already in 72 to the architect, either to be a dumb box and to kind of announce that in addition to being a dumb box, there was a monumental function almost as an afterthought, or to literally try to become an interesting building. Now, even a vaguely political reading of the architecture in the past two decades would suggest that except to accommodate the truly insignificant, the box was doomed by the forces of the market. Somehow, Reagan and Co. killed the generic. And so in that sense, one thing that Venturi could not foresee is that when he announced these two buildings and this opposition, that kind of somehow this opposition, which I think that intellectually is a kind of entirely tenable position, simply could not survive the kind of apotheosis of the market economy, because it could never and would never be interesting enough to really function in the market economy, and that it was only this kind of explicit and kind of overwhelming and pure sign that can survive. And so I would, in a way, claim that Venturi misread the situation or miscalculated the effect of the economy on this opposition, and that we are, ironically, from the moment that the World Trade Center was built, in a situation where more and more each of us architects is forced, whether whatever our predilections are, to be ducks, to produce ducks, and to kind of operate in the duck side of Venturi's spectrum, whether we want to or not. And then I would like to say that if you look at this one and this one, and I think, you know, they're kind of really the key kind of opposition at that point, because the AT&T building of Philip Johnson was not long after. It is a cruel irony that the amalgamation of a sympathy for America's commercial vernacular, which was Venturi's initial point of departure, and which I think Scott Brown kind of argued with Venturi into a system, provided the alibi for an American imperialism of history and context, from which even the most thoughtless generic modernism is a relief, and from which, beyond the obvious, such as graves, the entire spectrum from Skidmore to Jury to Gary are the unintended beneficiaries. Fortunately, there are no architecture tribunals yet, but it would be a tough assignment to settle whose crimes were bigger, Mises' crimes for launching the apotheosis of the box, or the Venturi for killing the box. And I think that it's, for me, a very beautiful and significant point of this moment, that on the one hand, with World Trade Center, perhaps the last, best, and the most beautiful box has disappeared, leaving us kind of orphaned, and while at the same time, for instance, an exhibition of Mies van der Rohe held in the same year gives an incredible new glamour to the box and perhaps a new promise. Anyway, this is simply by way of introduction, and I will later kind of return to the Venturi's more. What I'm showing you now is only kind of related to the previous part of the kind of presentation, in the sense that it is also a production by a couple, the couple Herzog and de Meuron and OMA, and that it is affected by the collapse of the World Trade Center, or indirectly reflected by the collapse of the World Trade Center. For a while, Hetzig and Demo and ourselves had the idea that we would want to work together on a kind of single project, and together in the most literal sense of the word, not to do a project together, but to really create a new entity that would produce this project where our individual kind of signature, identity, etc., would be subsumed in a larger whole. And that was on our part potential strategy to outgrow and escape from the kind of fatalities of the market economy, where usually we are played against each other, and where the fact that we have done an endless series of projects that were actually kind of doublings, and where each of us spent our own intelligence separately, and where each of us were caught in a strange invisible symmetry, namely where I could not do things that were similar to theirs, and where they could do not do things that were similar to ours. In other words, the competition was not only competition, not only fruitless, but also limited the repertoire of both of our possibilities, that we would work together in a project from scratch. The project, the first potential project that offered itself, was a hotel in New York for Ian Schrager, the well-known builder of the Schrager Hotels. And actually, builder is a misnomer, because until that moment, every Schrager Hotel had been a conversion, and usually Philip Stark had been involved in converting it from on the whole Art Deco environment into a more contemporary condition. This was the first time that Schrager was going to work with architects, and this was the first time that Schrager was going to work from scratch on a new building. The site is here, Astor Place, Lafayette, 8th Street, Cooper Union Building, in that part of Manhattan where the grids collide, and where instead of the kind of rigor of the grid situation, there is actually a kind of fairly diffuse and messy and incomprehensible condition. Ironically, the first version that we did, there is a kind of very significant and important large, one of the early 19th century buildings, early 20th century buildings that are complete extrusions, in this case white, one of the most beautiful, almost generic buildings that I know. It was a very intimidating presence, much more than Cooper Union. The first thing we thought about was to have a miniature, a cluster of miniature World Trade Centers, equally kind of abstract, standing and emerging from a pit. I actually only now notice this kind of similarity. The elevators would exist kind of between the buildings, and therefore connect them at kind of unpredictable points, but on the whole, they would be autonomous, and there would be 2 to 3 floors on each level. Of course, this idea was too expensive, and then we worked on a number of other alternatives. This was an attempt to create an inside-outside building out of foam rubber, but I'll come back to that later. And in the end, we simply for financial reasons, we had to choose for a shape that was largely dictated by the zoning law, that was fundamentally uninspired, in the sense that it was a straight calculation, but that it's derived its quality from two things, namely its appearance as a piece of rock, and secondly, the fact that it was floating over an open socle in which hidden was the communal program part of the hotel. In its kind of final configuration, the kind of building looked like this. An incredible piece of rock that was excavated where, and that was one of the important reasons, you could not specifically say where one room ended and another began, so that the kind of banality of the hotel condition was well hidden. And it was for this is the space underneath the hotel that was partly a swamp, partly a kind of public space. And this is a series of permutations where we looked to what extent we could reinvent the idea of an elevation by simply providing a totally other condition. Here she kind of mock-up built in Basel, a little bit clean, but eventually. And here you see it kind of from the inside, and here, sorry. You see Ian Schwager lying extremely uncomfortably kind of on the mock-up of a bed. And of course, this image alone kind of speaks for itself. Somehow we, the combined brain power of our two offices was never able to make Schwager forget the pleasures of working with Philip Stark. And undeniable qualities of those interiors were hard to read in our combined the combined Dutch-Swiss starkness, starkness ironically, so we had to make an endless number of versions, where this was perhaps the latest version, where we simply could not convince him of the quality of the kind of lunar rock. And then kind of finally proposed a more metallic skin with a number of excavations. And finally, floating over the socle. Sorry, yes. And one significant element of the kind of project was the addition of a Japanese capsule hotel that would enable Schwager to ask for considerably lower prices. Now, Schwager is working in a building that also includes a fair percentage of the important New York architects. Guotmi and Siegel is one office. Richard Meyer is another. During the kind of project, in our absence, Schwager not only frequently asked the opinion of Philip Stark, but also of Richard Meyer. It became very clear that our entry in the architectural domain of Manhattan was not going to be easy, because Manhattan is a kind of closed shop. And there has been kind of very little foreign penetration of its kind of architectural client relationships, and certainly that is also kind of related to the economy, because it is very clear that the vast majority of commissions, practically all the commissions in New York, are private and no longer public, and it may need a public client to impose Europeans in this context. So it was a particular pleasure for Richard Meyer, which he explored in a number of interviews in the American press and also in the foreign press, among the Dutch press, to point out weaknesses of our project. One of the weaknesses of the kind of project of this one was that the individual capsules had no bathrooms. That showed that we were creepy architects who had no place in America. It is, of course, very paradoxical that thanks to the Venturi alibi of both context and historicism, American architects, as you know, kind of work in a large scale in Europe, usually invoking their particular contextual abilities. The second project I want to show is a project which we are doing for the Whitney, which is an extension of the Whitney. I will go a little bit faster because it's kind of a fresher project. Of course, or not of course, basically we were fired from the Astor Place project. And almost before you could go like this, and perhaps even before you could go like this, Frank Gehry was appointed to be our replacement, and was only too ready to build his first realization in Manhattan. And regretfully, the events of September 11th have made an end also for that enterprise, so that it's a safe prediction that Ian Schrager will never in his life build a new hotel. because the average occupancy rate of hotels in New York is lower than 20. The New Whitney is our second attempt to build in Manhattan. And this time we are building alone because Hetzer and Dumont and ourselves are still waiting for the next opportunity to do a project together. But it's unlikely to be in America. This is the Whitney building by Breuer from 74. An incredibly beautiful building that has a very original relationship with the street. It inverts the typical Manhattan profile, and instead of setbacks up, has setbacks down. This was the time when architects were still considered glamorous. And this was the kind of famous project that was built, proposed for the site in the 80s by the architect Michael Graves. I don't want to dwell on it or kind of laugh about it. Basically, this is the Whitney. There was going to be a kind of counterpart to the Whitney on the site where there's a number of brownstones. And within the existing zoning envelope, there was kind of fairly palatial extension. And I think that this space was the boardroom that straddled the two buildings. Somehow it was a building that Graves could never get kind of beyond the New York Landmarks Commission. So in a number of permutations and changes, the project died a very quiet death, but last year we were asked by the Whitney board whether we could look at kind of the idea of resuming extending the Whitney, and we got a kind of very ambiguous brief whether we could maintain the brownstones, but the subtext or the unspoken part of it was whether we could create such a masterpiece that the city would beg us to take down the brownstones that are protected as part of a historic district. So innocently we started with a number of permutations. We could not convince ourselves that building an equivalent building or a building next to it was actually could ever lead to a kind of interesting result. And it was only when we got the sense that whatever we did, it had to be more unstable and not consist of two but of three parts, that we became interested and excited. We then started to look at the brownstones themselves, and perhaps a typically Dutch kind of impression that actually I didn't want to destroy any part of Manhattan, certainly if it was not necessary, kind of asserted itself. So we began to look at the possibilities of creating a third building and extending the Whitney at the same time. What it meant, and here you have the kind of situation, this is Boris building, this is an existing block of brownstones, here is a second one, that if you would launch a third element, you would have to launch it from a very kind of reduced footprint and a tiny courtyard at the center, so that it would be a kind of fairly complex operation in terms of a building. There's a drawing of the zoning law. You all know the zoning law. It's kind of a series of setbacks. And so when we combined the idea of a kind of very small footprint, the necessary volume, and the zoning envelope, with the idea of maintaining the ground zones, we got a shape which is kind of roughly like this. That could also be articulated, and in this project too, we are working with over Arab. That could also be articulated as a kind of less massive form, but as a form that could be a composite of concrete and steel where the tension would be strongest, and concrete where compression was strongest. When we thought about saving the brownstones, we looked at the beginnings of the Whitney, and they had basically started the museum in a kind of domestic scale. And we also looked at the collection, and the entire part of the pre-war collection is actually fairly modestly scaled paintings. And then it became exciting to counteract the current tendency of continuously increasing scales for new museums by simply maintaining the brownstones and using their kind of very smallness technically as a place where we could show smaller art and create a kind of situation where the pre-war section of the Whitney could be accommodated in this quasi-domestic scale. Then there could be a transition in the Whitney building itself, which whose scale alone had provoked an explosion of the scale of American art in the 60s and 70s, and then switch to the new part of the museum. We also felt it was important that we find a way of maintaining in a contemporary museum a situation where the original museum experience, which is confrontation with an individual piece of art, is maintained, but where all the other additional entities, such as they are now indispensable, like museum store, restaurant, etc., are not seen as encroachment on the exhibitions or interference with the exhibition, but are articulated as an equivalent part that we called experience, and that then demands its own architectural character and specificity. Sorry. So that is what you have here. The brownstones, the old Whitney. What we were able to do is to kind of extend the existing core with that huge elevator, to maintain that elevator, to make it go through the roof, literally, and enter the new volume, so that in spite of the three-partite organization of the new thing, it's still highly centralized, or even more centralized than it ever was, around this core, and a series of escalators that go up but not down in the new part. As part of the experience, we propose that some of the art is to be enjoyed at a kind of faster pace than usual, and that the entire museum can be enjoyed at different velocities and different degrees of independence and organization. It was interesting that the artists that we worked with actually had a strong preference to be either in the brownstones or in the experience, and did not want to be in a museum. This is a study of the structural behavior of the skin, which enables us to judge where you could penetrate or open it. Clearly, in the darker parts, there's more stresses than the upper part. So based on that, we proposed a series of almost lace-like penetrations in concrete skin. And by using a new kind of glass that changes color as you move to create here a series of very strict collages that show you the effect of the building in the context. Scene from Park Avenue. I think partly as an through the effect of the September 11, the Whitney board decided to accelerate the project to show its commitment to the future of New York. I now want to come back to the Venturis and look through the Venturis, through the eyes of the Venturis at Las Vegas again. For the Harvard Guide to Shopping, we did two things: a reconstruction of Las Vegas since 72, the year that the Venturis had looked at it, but we also had an interview with the Venturis in which we tried to kind of assess their current opinion about Las Vegas, and also asked them to kind of reflect on any differences between Las Vegas then and Las Vegas now. And so some of this is based on that interview and on their kind of own and on the discussion that followed. I would first have to show the essential differences. This is the strip from the learning from Las Vegas as it was in their book. As you can see here, it has become a much less incidentally urban condition. It seems an almost continuous urban condition. Here we see the urban area of Las Vegas when the Venturis looked at it and its extension. It is now, I think, 514 miles. So that is an absolutely explosive growth that makes it almost inevitable to conclude that however weird and strange Las Vegas is, that it is undeniably a city. In almost every level I can't quite read all these elements, but from retail to marriages to death, to there is the same incredible curve of growth. And from hotel rooms, divorces, etc., etc. And if you look at Las Vegas now, and if you look at the kind of principal parts of Venturi's theories, you wonder and have to wonder, and this was the question that we were asking them, you know, does your theory still hold? Because I think that the fundamental theory that the Venturi Scott Brown derived from Las Vegas is that from that point in the 20th century, mass and substance would be less important than science, and that science were going to organize significance, leaving much more modest tasks to building. But if we look now at Las Vegas, we see that and where in 72 it was actually a city dominated by science, we can now question that and wonder whether we don't have a situation of science dominated by buildings. In 72, Venturi drew this diagram. And the diagram was very clear. There is the box, there's a sign on the box, then there's the parking, the road, the parking, the road, and the kind of much bigger kind of totemic element that kind of signifies the building without being the building. One thing that was absolutely fascinating in the interview was to hear that for the Venturis, the impulse and the initiative to look at Las Vegas had nothing to do initially with America or with America, American commercialism, but that Denise Venturi drew a straight line from earlier researches she had pursued in London in the context or close to the AA, and even earlier to her youth in South Africa and her first steps on the world of architecture and art. According to Scott Brown, learning from Las Vegas started when she was a teenager in South Africa, and where a Dutch teacher told her to escape from Western civilization and to open her eyes to the immediate environment and to begin to take that seriously and to look at Africa. And that is, she says, what she did. Then she came as a committed and probably hardcore socialist to London in the early 50s. And there she became close to a group that also included Henderson, eventually was not far removed from the Smithsons, and that began to look very closely at the landscape of the East End, London's East End. And so for her, there were kind of simply three very simple steps: Africa, London East End, and Las Vegas. And that is kind of really the impulse, and not so. It is a cruel irony that the amalgamation of a sympathy for America's commercial vernacular, prepared by a hardcore socialist appreciation of London's East End working class culture, and before that an opening to the truly African, combined with a somewhat epicene probing of the intricacies of European historical precedent with its push and pull of imposition and deflection, a true social aesthetic anthropological witch's brew, led to the performance and the kind of condition and the situation of the Venturis. So for Venturi, this was Las Vegas in 72, but what he actually maintained, it is still Las Vegas now, because basically the buildings have become ducks and are inflated to the scales of signs. And it is undeniably true. There is a New York hotel in the shape of New York, with very significantly no World Trade Center. There is a pyramid, and it's certainly true that some of the buildings in New York have been inflated to the size of incredibly big signs. But this was my counter reading. At the same time, there's also a looming and incredibly inert, built, undefined, colossal Las Vegas of simply buildings that overwhelm the science. So this was kind of really the nature of our discussion. Venturi would say, it's still this, and my claim was, it is now this. Anyway, we looked at, as I said, as part of the Harvard context, we actually looked at Las Vegas and how it had evolved. And what was most surprising and kind of most intriguing was not only that each casino had become bigger, and that each casino, to some extent, of course, repeated the facilities of each of the other ones, but at the same time, there is now what you could call a kind of real urbanism being generated, in the sense that there are connections between casinos that in a certain way could be said to be fairly similar to the connections that were proposed first in urbanism, and the nature of connections, more organic connections than rigorous connections, that were perhaps first proposed by Team 10 and similar thinkers. So whether intentionally or not, or accidentally or not, there is now also, apart from the kind of separate Las Vegas, kind of continuous topological Las Vegas, where the autonomy of the buildings is actually counteracted by a network of connection and tentacle. And in this kind of situation, we were asked to do two museums, one for the Hermitage and one for the Guggenheim, in and embedded, largely embedded in a casino. And here you see the casino, and of course the casino is, although worse and less architectural, not unsimilar to the kind of architecture that the Venturis are now producing. One of the kind of really interesting little footnotes of the Venturis' career is that when I asked how many buildings they had done, and expecting something in the low teens, Denise Cotbarn very immediately and without hesitation said that they were now up to 180 buildings. So not only have they had the luxury of being relatively unpopular, but probably in the kind of stealth condition of that unpopularity, produced enormous amounts of very intense architectures. So So what you see here, this is the casino itself. This is the first phase. There is a kind of imaginary line here. And this is the second phase. This is embedded the Hermitage Museum, where the Guggenheim and the Hermitage will show together real paintings, and paintings of an incredible caliber. And this is wedged between a parking lot and a hotel. It's a kind of huge Kunsthalle for the Guggenheim. And basically, the elements are independent, and not independent, but they are part of the kind of circulation flow of the museum, of the casino itself. There is a notion, and I think that September 11th will also be influential on that notion, that if these two become successful, then the casino will, in the second phase, change its nature completely and become a museum and become the first hotel museum. So it is also the beginning of Las Vegas potentially abandoning its strictly commercial condition. The Kunsthalle is more or less a found object. All we have to do is create a roof and an entrance door. It's a kind of incredibly monumental space. The entrance door kind of more or less goes to the outside, to the desert, and running through it is a trench. This is the wall of the parking garage, incompletely covered. It's a trench that gives access to rooms on either side. And there is a roof that opens and would enable you to have certain exhibitions in the open air. The opening was last week, Friday, and was equally grotesquely inappropriate after September 11th as the Venturi Symposium, but in this case it was on the other side of America. It was celebrated with the arrival of a kind of motorcycle club led by Tom Krenz, the director of the Guggenheim, of which Lauren Hutton is also an important part. And she's here being congratulated for her recovery, because with an equal motorcycle trip that was organized at the beginning, she had a terrible accident and nearly died. So basically, the construction of the museum is bracketed with her recovery. The three inevitables, Dennis Hopper, Lauren Hutton, and Jeremy Irons, at the opening of the... you see here our Kunsthalle, and you see the display for the first show, a motorcycle show, designed by Van Gary. So we are now almost coming full circle, and this is also, I think, a typical part of the world of the market economy. No one ever really makes a choice, but all choices are combined. Sometimes we're replaced by Gary, sometimes Gary is our interior, sometimes, in other words, we are irrevocably tied to Gary, as we are to all the others. But, of course, you may wonder, and I'm certainly wondering, whether in the September 11th situation, And I can only read it in the same in a kind of mixture of competitiveness and ideology, whether the kind of starkness of the one is going to be more significant than the voluptuousness of the other. You know that the Guggenheim is also planning a second museum in Wall Street area by Frank Gehry, and after September 11th. A project was launched to combine the new Guggenheim with the new building for the New York Stock Exchange, so as to replace the World Trade Center. So there's a lot of movement going on in American architecture. And that would be a kind of hybrid of a boldness. So for a president. So here we see the Gehry display, the inside of the Gehry displays, outside metal, inside. The walls, Then there is a fragment of our architecture, which is a big staircase that is also an auditorium. And something that I would like to call a way out, a huge door. Then you go through the casino to the Hermitage. Here is the kind of art hall. You go through the casino to the Hermitage. The Hermitage, contrary to the Guggenheim building, the Hermitage has an exterior. It is a box and a note that, in spite of their impopularity, both these buildings are boxes. The big box of the council and the so-called jewel box of the Hermitage. It is a kind of smaller box which is kind of embedded in the casino, and where, in order to protect the aura of the real paintings, we felt we had to create a kind of strong box, because I think that never before have two kinds of culture being so closely juxtaposed. I think you can kind of sneer at it as a kind of irrelevant effort, but at the same time, I think it's impossible not to look at the whole striving of modernism in terms of creating not so much a resolution, but a merger of popular and high culture, or at least to create an equivalence between them. And I believe that this is what one of the aspects that this project offers. But in order to assert and protect the aura of reality, we built the entire building out of cord and steel. And so even the paintings are displayed on steel with surprising fact. The building is handled as a rectangle that smashes and cuts through the sheetrock of the museum, sometimes brutally, as in this case, and of the decoration. The painting is displayed directly on the curtain, hung with magnets. Here you see the interior. We don't have any good pictures yet. And the museum store is a piece of the Venetian interior, simply covered in plastic. And the real expectation is, and this is where I think the market economy is again kind of the primordial connection and the primordial given. The expectation is that the money earned in Las Vegas will enable the Hermitage to extend its buildings in St. Petersburg and create a second buildings that enables them there to present a much larger part of their collection. For me, the connective thread between all these elements is the market economy, but not only the market economy, but also everything that it entails. I think the greatest implication of the market economy has been, on the one hand, a merger between almost all activities, partly because they have to be supported by sources of income that are other than they generate, and that are other than the subsidies that the state traditionally gave to what was public. What we see here, it's again not that readable, but that the kind of the essence of shopping is that, and the development of shopping is that, from a kind of more or less autonomous activity, it has now, over the past 30 years, infiltrated almost every activity known to man, whether it is museums, airports, schools, churches, etc., etc. And obviously, shopping is itself the key indicator of the market economy. And therefore, what we have witnessed very clearly is, on one hand, an erosion of the public and a replacement of the public by the private and, at best, the quasi-public. But what we also have witnessed to enable all of this is a kind of systematic deregulation The devices for that infiltration have been, of course, the escalator and the air conditioning system, because only they have been enabled for architecture to extend in all directions and to provoke and generate the condition of seamlessness that we are currently witnessing. I've written for the shopping book an article called Junk Space, which for me is a term that kind of best defines the spatial condition of this past 20 years, which is characterized on the one hand by artificiality, the artificiality of conditioned air, by on the other hand by smoothness, the smoothness of internal circulation and transport, and perhaps most significantly exacerbated by the needs of the market economy, invariably interesting, never boring, and all of that has been able to be generated by deregulation, whether it's the deregulation of airspace, the deregulation of airport kind of security, the deregulation of the economy, the deregulation of kind of financial flows. And in that sense, I think it is not difficult to see the immediate connection or the ultimate connection that basically straddles the entire world, and that through a system of deregulation that, you know, starts perhaps at the scale of the individual building, but that now holds all of us captive in a kind of system of deregulation that in itself has enabled or defined September 11th, where all the kind of successive pieces of deregulation kind of formed for the first time perhaps an impeccable arc of possibility. These are pictures of the World Trade Center in construction, and it is clear that something like that by this system can never be generated anymore. And it is also clear, and it is almost laughable, that the most intense debate about what to do with World Trade Center site is, of course, the debate among New York architects. Basically, the site is owned by somebody private, a developer, and the developer has apparently already hired the services of Skidmore, Owing & Merrill. And therefore, basically, the conclusion in architectural terms seems foregone, kind of regardless of the meaning of the event and its potential needs and meaning. That's where I want to end. Thank you.
Questions. Maybe if there are people who want to leave, they could leave quickly so that we could have a few questions for Rem. Who would like to start? Charles, is there somebody who could pass the mic around? Speak to the mic, sir.
It was a time in American architecture when it's kind of kitsch Gothic was being applied, and stainless steel Gothic was what he was doing to it too. So the way he sold it and the way it was seen at the time was combining the box. I mean, you see it as the box, but a lot of people see it as those arches, and his arches in Seattle and in his other work. Harvard, as a kind of, like Stone's work, a sellout of modernism. So what I'm amazed at is that you've dropped away all of the that veneer, which is you look over and you assimilate it to the.
Charles, I'm really happy that you asked this question. Because it enables me to give the real answer. What I said to Venturi, that you know we have killed the World Trade Center before it was actually eliminated. We have killed it by being completely incapable of understanding it as a building, by having a completely trivial kind of discussion about kind of some of its architectural detail, by completely looking at it as a kind of issue of style. But if you now look at New York with or without Trade Center, you look on one hand at a city that represents still, no matter how remotely, the idea of modernity. I tell you that New York without Trade Center looks like a city dominated by an Art Deco building and largely like a kind of sad...
You mean Pelé?
No, I mean the World Trade, the Empire State Building, which is still the tallest, which is now the tallest building in New York. So it is kind of really in one moment the city regressed into an incredible condition, and all the architectural world, I've read all the kind of reviews. The reviews are unbelievable and kind of and really outrageous in their kind of focusing, for instance, in this detail and rejecting something on the level of detail whose significance kind of blatantly and clearly had a kind of citywide impact and established to a large extent the status of the entire city.
How can you end with chastising SOM? I mean, it seems to me that you're getting the same thing, and you can't criticize SOM and uphold the Yamasaki's ability. It's not simply a question of style of the name.
No, it is a...
Yeah, I mean, there are deeper
issues. Basically, the deeper issue that the World Trade Center in the 70s was a public building operation. Because it was public, it had a different meaning. Because it was public, it could be bigger, it could kind of clear a larger site than could be was possible before. So in the accumulation of private gestures, which is New York, there are two assertions of kind of something larger than that. There's Central Park, there's Rockefeller Center, there is the United Nations, and there is kind of finally the World Trade Center. And I think that in the meantime, the World Trade Center has been sold, and now it is in private hands. And you know what happens if a private client goes to Skidmore. It will not be a kind of modern building, but it will be a contextual building, whatever contextual in this context will be. And I know that kind of Skidmore has already proposed not two buildings of 100 stories, but four buildings of 50 stories. So that is contextual.
Well, one more point.
The
historical one. I mean, you are playing very fast in this with history. If you believe that the origin of Las Vegas, I mean, do you know that, what's his name, in Vreeland, Tim Vreeland, when the Venturis were lecturing in Albuquerque, put by their bed table, a copy of Tom Wolfe's essay on Las Vegas. They read that night, and the next morning they went off and drove to Las Vegas, and that was the origin. What I'm saying is that to assimilate it to Denise's words is as false as to overlook you know perfectly well that Wolfe was instrumental in opening a lot of Venturi's eyes to electrographic architecture, just as he was with Archigram. Just So, I mean, I just don't accept either historical position or the...
Well, I think there has been a kind of long-standing tradition not to take Denise Scott Brown seriously. Sure. I'm proud to brag with that, because I think that she is actually... And I think that the reason is not so much that she's a woman, but the reason is that she has a sociological interest, which is very unfashionable in architectural circles and which is a very inconvenient luggage if in the age of the market economy. Yes? And I think that that is a... I think that's a much more significant kind of issue than the claim that somebody else has opened their eyes, because eyes are usually opened at more or less at the same time, more or less for the same reasons, in more than one place.
Well, in both cases, I'm just asking you for a more nuanced approach.
Give the other position.
Who would like to? Maybe I can ask you, since you started with the beginning and with learning from Las Vegas and the 70s, and in some ways I referred to Delirious New York, and, yeah. and in a sense that book's your own sort of idealistic reading of the city in the context of then all this last 20 or 30 years. How do you feel your own perception of the city has changed? Is there a sort of possibility of things that happened in Delirious New York? Can they happen the way that you're reading it? It seems that in terms of the relationship between architects, the manner that practice happens, that now there is also a very different New York.
Well, I think that Delirious New York was never even remotely intended for New York. And it was kind of really trying to describe a space that could be occupied in different cities by different people, and that really would enable another kind of approach. But I think that my optimism now, and I'd be kind of really naive and embarrassing, is that somehow this accumulated junk that has been kind of generated and to which everyone has made their contribution will, kind of, in retrospect, begin to look as necessary to be redirected in some form. Mm. And what that form will be, I think, is impossible to say. But I think that we cannot, at the same time, moan about vulgarity and wholeheartedly endorse the market economy. So it's or not moan about terrorism and endorse deregulation.
Never seen such a silent crowd. I'm back there, Ariel. Can you wait for the mic? Because people upstairs can't hear.
You mentioned the paradigm of the duck in your lecture. And is this a kind of sort of an operational system that you feel comfortable working within, or is it something that you kind of feel
no, no, it's a drawing by Venturi, and I think that if you the tone of my lecture was indicating that I feel partly uncomfortable working in it, and that is partly caused by an inability to do ducks.
Any other points of clarification?
Okay, that's ended.
No, okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Also, because you're now reading between the Venturis, the city, what is happening to your own project, what's happening there. I think there are a lot of kind of interesting forces But I meant also with the question, not that you see the city itself as the mechanism that can have this kind of generosity of reading. So now, the reading that you have is...